There's so much noise. Everybody wants to have a point of view. Everybody wants either to show how splendid they are or to show how awful the world is, and people want to paint a picture of an apocalypse. But the fact is, if you listen to the scientific advisors, they almost always begin every sentence with, "We think it's possible, maybe, perhaps, we don't know, but." That's how experts talk, people who really understand it.
I totally agree with everything you're saying, but what I don't accept is mainstream media immediately slapping that down as not true when they don't know it's not true. No one should attack or damage or do anything like that, but it's very easy to say it is not true because it suits the state narrative. That's all I would say as someone with an inquiring mind.
I can't comment on the individual decisions.
What can you comment on, out of interest? We all know they had the test. They've admitted it. Why are you laughing? What do you find funny? Seriously, why do you keep laughing? I don't get it.
I don't think I am laughing.
You literally just laughed again.
It feels like you're attempting to score points.
No, I'm asking you straightforward questions. You're saying the priority is health workers, the tests, and I'm telling you the priority actually has been for politicians. Why?
So I just think we're in an incredibly serious situation as a country when we're tackling a global pandemic, which has brought health systems to their knees.
Yeah, we know
all
that.
Which has brought economies to their standstill. Yeah, but that's why having some kind of ping pong back and forth.
No, these are straightforward questions. You said the priority for testing was frontline healthcare workers. I said actually they're not getting them. It's the politicians. That was the question. You think that's ping pong? It's not ping pong. Let me ask you this as well. You've been on the airwaves this morning talking about how valued you think health workers are, right? Nurses, mm-hmm. doctors, surgeons.
Well, I think it's really important that we show our appreciation. And I think people do really value health workers. And as I say, I'm talking about social care workers who don't tend to get the same airtime.
In June 2017, when there was a vote to increase the pay of health workers from the capped 1%, how did you vote?
I think you're referring to a vote on an amendment to the Queen's Speech, which is the government's programme.
How did you vote in pay rises for nurses in 2017?
So I have supported pay rises for nurses. We are giving nurses.
So you voted in favour of the cap being lifted, did you?
So I have supported pay rises for nurses.
Can you answer my question?
If there was a particular political trick when an opposition tabled an amendment to a Queen's Speech, which is a government's programme, and it was some political game playing.
Yeah, it's not actually a game. You were one of the many MPs, actually, who voted against the cap being lifted. So these nursing staff that you value so highly, they didn't actually warrant any pay rise above 1% from your perspective. And in fact, I want to play you the reaction of Parliament from the Tories when you managed to win that debate and actually stopped the nurses getting a pay rise. This is what happened in Parliament.
The ayes to the right, 309. The noes to the left, 323. Yeah.
A tremendous cheer at the fact that people like these nurses that you value so highly were not getting any more money than 1%. And coincidentally, of course, you politicians gave yourselves much more than 1%, didn't you?
Well, on the politician, you know that we do not make decisions about our own pay.
That's you could turn them down, though, couldn't you? You could say, I'm not going to take more than the 1% if you value the health workers that much. My point being, there's a lot of chat being given to how much we value health workers. And yet, when it mattered was probably when they could have done with a bit more money to pay for the parking fines they're getting at hospitals, to pay perhaps indeed for the PPE that so many of them don't have, either in care homes or on the NHS front line, to pay perhaps for testing that they haven't been able to get because so many politicians and celebrities and footballers have been getting the tests ahead of them. So when it comes to valuing them and prioritising them, shouldn't you just actually start to talk less and walk more?
So, Piers, you know the political system, I'm sure, better. So you know well enough that the government needs to pass its Queen's Speech unamended in order to carry out the job of government. So the particular vote you were talking about was some political posturing, I'm afraid. But what matters is actually that we have been increasing the pay of nurses, particularly the nurses on lower pay bands, because actually we're determined to make sure that our healthcare staff are well rewarded financially for what they do. We're also working really hard on to make sure that nurses and social care workers, health and social care workers, have the PPE that they need. I'm well aware of the concerns and the worries that people have had as to whether
Matt Hancock suggested. In fact, let's play the clip of what he suggested.
There's one other thing. And one other change I want to make, which is giving people the right to say goodbye. One of the important things that care homes do is support people at the end of their life. Sadly, even in normal times, each month, about 10,000 people die in care homes.
That's mad, isn't it?
Ridiculous. Yeah.
Fucking joke. Get the fuck out of here. Absolute bastards. That is disgusting, isn't it?
We go. You were also, of course, Foreign Secretary. We know that there's 15,000 people arriving at airports every day. Is it right that they are not being checked?
Well, I hope that advice will be reviewed because, again, if you look at international best practice, countries like Taiwan and Korea, that was one of the very first things they did was either stop flights from areas with a lot of coronavirus, or make sure that everyone who had come from those areas was quarantined and tested. So I hope as we roll out the testing, we will look at doing that for international arrivals.
Okay.
Secretary, for people to stay at home to avoid transmitting the virus. Why are we still having all our airports open to people flying in from corona hotspots like New York, like Italy, like China? It doesn't make sense to people that we're allowing tens of thousands of people a day to come into our airports, walk into our communities without even a basic test, given that we know many people can be asymptomatic. Can you explain?
Well, we do, of course. Have different treatment for people who've come from different places according to how serious the outbreak
is.
How
many people are you testing at airports when they land? Like yesterday, day before, how many are you testing?
Well, we don't routinely test at airports because the number of people coming through has dropped very dramatically, and so there is very, very low amounts.
How many have come in this week?
It's about 15,000 a day at the moment from the data.
50,000 people have come into the country this week and they walk into the communities without any tests, without any check if they're carrying the virus, even if they've come from a place like New York, which is now the epicenter of coronavirus.
Well, I have a lot of sympathy with what you're saying, Piers, because it matters that we... that we reduce the rate of transmission. At the current rate of transmission here, then the scientists say that the epidemiological impact of keeping the travel open is very small because there's already large transmission here. But what I want to do is see the transmission rates here come down, which is why following this guidance is so important. And at that point, as other countries have, We may need to. But I'm not going to get into the speculation.
All right. The key to this, we're all agreed.
Thank you for those words. Chief Silvestre Nicale, would you care to just give your overview on the status quo as a cultural leader, paramount chief of Côte d'Ivoire in Africa? You have an exceptional voice. Please address the court on the status quo.
This is pandemic case is a serious matter for us, because when the coronavirus broke out in China and in Italy, then it came to Europe, African didn't have any case at all. And we did not believe that it was coming there. I personally did not believe that we will know this case in Africa, because we don't have any 5G antenna there yet. And if we don't have 5G antennas, then this coronavirus couldn't reach Africa. But we were really surprised when we understood from the Secretary General of United Nations talking about being concerned with Africa. We did not understand why, instead of being concerned with Europe, with Italy, with Spain, they start talking about Africa. Then the French President Emmanuel Macron, in a visit in Alsace, where he went to speak about a hospital, a military hospital, he then spoke to the French doctors, French scientists, to go to Africa and show the know-how about this disease. So those, I start thinking, what is really going on? Because so far, Africa is not really linked to this disease. We know that all those pandemic are always starting from Africa. We know Ebola, we know HIV. But this coronavirus did not start in Africa. So how come all the world leaders are talking about concern with Africa? Then I start receiving phone calls from back home, villages. The chief from a village are complaining because the vaccination started already in the village. People were going around in village, one of my village called Siegweku. The chief wanted to understand why they were having agents going to give vaccine to children from 6 to 13 years old. They did not understand what was going on. Then I said to them, just speak to the authority over there. They then caught those agents and they went to the authority in the cities. Then they found out that those people were working for organization owned by Bill Gates, and they were released. Those are things that you will not see, you will not hear about in the media. So people are already going, giving vaccine in my villages. So this is a serious concern, because I don't believe if there is, at this stage, there is a vaccine for corona. But they are giving vaccine in my villages. Some videos and phone calls that I received saying that 7 children died in Senegal, a village near Dakar, where people went to vaccine children in a compound. 7 of them died on streets on after the vaccination. I received also videos and phone calls from Ivory Coast, a small village near Abidjan, the capital city called Anono. The government sent agents accompanied by police to build up some tent for vaccine. The chief of village refused. The whole youth refused. They were backing the village authority. Then they were from 7 o'clock in the morning till seven. So I don't really understand what is going on. So if this tribunal can do something about it, because no one can speak about it, if the authority is already planning this mass vaccination in Africa, I don't understand. So I just address this court to try and find a solution for what's happening.
What for? Mark, are you harassing me? What for? I haven't done nothing wrong. Tell these, mate. What?
Go on. No, you've done nothing wrong.
Give me the details. Sit in your car, shut up. And if you want to fucking step to me and put your chest out and stuff like that, then fine. I'll lock you up. We'll do that, shall we? I'll make something up. Pull the cord. Screw up to a police officer. Should I do that? Who are they going to believe? Me or you? Who are they going to believe? Me or you?
I will do, man. Don't worry about it.
Is that cool? Now, 2 and 4, 24. Just bear in mind, we need a nice low call, everyone. I'm all the way down here. We need a nice low call if we get it. 2 and 3, 23. 1 and 9, 19.
Again, don't know where, don't know what.